Session 38 of the Book of Deuteronomy. We continue with chapter 30. And we are still cutting deep after the previous session talking about physical and spiritual circumcision. Let's cut a little bit deeper into our own reality. Today is 2022, January 24. And if we just put on the TV or look at the newspaper or try to go to a shop, or try and go to certain jobs, we are faced with persecution. We are faced with the reality of the enemy of God who is trying to take over all the truth and all the law that guides us to truth. Take it over and twist it and change it, just like they tried through the fallen angel. Teachings. Remember Genesis 6, we discussed that. We talked about the book of Enoch. Since Genesis 3, when the serpent took God's law, God's instructions, God's warnings, God's truth, and he just twisted it. And if you don't follow the narrative, remember the road is wide. Most people follow the narrative. And if you don't follow the narrative, you are of the small amount of people. Few are on the narrow road. Few were, in the Garden of Eden, nobody stood up against the serpent. That's the big problem. But in Noah's time, the Bible says only 8 of the whole world was saved during the first judgment of the whole world. Because there is few that will stand up. The world is going because it is against the instructions of the God they believe in. And because you stand up for that, even though you're only 1 in a family or 2 in a city, as the prophet says, you will be persecuted. We have to make in these final days. And I'm not, remember, I hope you've done the Bible studies regarding the rapture and all those end time events on the Two Trees YouTube channel. When we say we're in the last days, we are not saying like the whole world is saying and the church is saying Jesus can come tomorrow. We are not saying that we will be raptured soon. I'm actually also not even saying that Yeshua is coming soon. If you understand the prophecies and you read Revelation, you will see that there's a lot that still has to happen within the Antichrist system. Way before the 7 plagues of God, the judgments of Revelations even starts falling. We are not close to that time yet, but we are in the end times of these things starting in the birth pains of the pregnant woman. We are already feeling the birth pains. We are in the end times, but Yeshua is not coming tomorrow or the day after tomorrow. And for that, you'll have to stick around for more studies so that we can also understand the timeline. We don't put times, we don't predict dates. But anyway, back to the fact that only few will stand up. And we stand up because we've learned that following what the world is currently mandating is against the law and the instructions and the will of the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of Noah. Noah was the only one clear and clean and perfect in his genetics, and clean and perfect in his genetics during the time of the genetic manipulation of the fallen angel incursion. Only 8 people, only Noah and his family. That's why when we read and understand the Torah, we also hear at Shema, the instruction that God says, you teach your children diligently when you stand up, when you lie down, when you walk by the road, when you're in your house, because only 8 people. If Noah didn't teach his children diligently, it would only have been Noah and his wife, maybe. If Noah and his wife wasn't one, echad, in their belief and their service and worship of Yahuwah, it would only have been 1 person on the ark. But every man has to bring his wife into covenant with Father Yahuwah. And then the husband covenant. That's why there was eight. There was Noah and his wife and his three sons with their three daughters, with their three wives. And we don't know how believing these wives were, but nevertheless, at the end of the day, there are few that will stand up. And when you stand up, the curses of God will not fall upon you. Unfortunately, we are in a cursed world, and the cursed world is our that which surrounds us. So we are not taken away from the cursed world at this stage. But the curses of God that's coming upon this world will not come upon the children that chooses to obey Him and stay away from the breaking of God's law and the following of the law of the serpent. Law of the serpent. Because it's worse to fall under the curses of God than to suffer the inconvenience of the retaliation of this world and of the wrath of the God of this dark kingdom. It's better to rather endure that, endure to the end, so that we can receive the crown of life, eternal life. So we suffer for a while. Paul says we endure for a while, knowing what is to follow after this. But also knowing that if we choose to rather follow the world and follow the narrative that every religious, political, educational, medical, and media institution is currently following, then we will stand under the same banner of the rest of the world who will receive the curses from God. And that is worse. I'm telling you, it's going to be worth your while to stand up for what you believe in and to remain faithful even during trials and tribulation and persecution. And now I encourage you again to take a pink highlighter and just highlight the following verse. Deuteronomy 30, verse 7. Because we've just concluded verse 1 to 6. God has cut deep into our hearts with His sword, the two-edged sword. It's better that He cuts us now than we fall under the cutting when the lion from the tribe of Judah comes on the white horse with his glimmering sword in his hand that is going to drip with the blood when he brings execution upon this world with his sword. He's going to bring the curse of God upon this world that does not fall under the covenant with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We choose to obey Him, because disobedience brings the curses. Mount Ebal, Mount Gerizim. We stand on these mountains, we declare the curses, we declare the blessings. You remember all the curses that we have gone through. You remember the curses of eating your children. You remember the curses of your enemy will fall upon you seven ways. You remember that your going in and your coming out will be cursed, and your house, your family, your children. You remember those things. So all those curses that we have discussed in the previous sessions, listen to what Yahuwah is promising you. Verse 7, Yahuwah your Elohim will put all these curses upon your enemies. Yahuwah will put these curses upon them that hate you. Yahuwah will put these curses upon them who persecute you. Let them hate you. Let the enemies of humanity, the enemies of God, the enemies of the Torah, the enemies of the people that are standing up against the worldwide governmental indoctrination against the government of God. Let those enemies hate you and persecute you. Now the hatred and the persecution, we can only feel slightly. You only feel it slightly when you have conversations with colleagues at work, or with people at school, or with people in a shop, or standing in a queue, or in your church. You only feel the persecution slightly when you're accused of not following the mandates because conspiracist. But the persecution and the hatred will become more and more and more. Remember, Yeshua warned, they will hate you for my sake. That is not only for the sake of the gospel. We've been taught all our lives that when you follow Jesus, you'll be hated by the world because you preach forgiveness and all those kind of things. I want to bring something to your attention. Forgiveness is a very good and a very nice thing. And that is what we have been made to believe all our lives, that in the end times, persecution will only come upon Christians that are nice to each other and that wants to bring people out from their drinking and smoking and dancing, you know, out of those kinds of sins, back to the cross. And people that wants to bring people into church and get them out of the dancing, you know, that kind of persecution is indeed so. But we've been, let me just read this verse to you. And I don't know who of you know Yapi. I'm not sure even what Yapi's surname is. But he's a lekker Vrystaat Afrikaanse boer. And he's forever putting stuff on Facebook as well. And this weekend, one of you guys sent me a video clip of his. Just talking about this whole, let us be like, you know, something lying on the ground. Let people trample over us. Because when Yeshua was hanging on the cross, he prayed in Luke 23, verse 34. And he said, while they were killing him, while they were mocking him, while they were spitting upon him, while they were accusing him unfairly, while they brought false witnesses against him, while they were killing him without reason, persecuting him, he prayed, Father, forgive them, please, for they do not know what they do. Because of this verse, we have been taught that the persecution that we will be under, and that we will have to endure, will be very similar to what Yeshua endured. And we just have to forgive. We have to be floor mats that is trampled upon. And we just have to turn the other cheek. And we just have to forgive. And be nice little Christians like Yeshua was. And it's almost like the persecution is because we are so humble that we will be persecuted so badly. And I'm saying no. The absolute thing to stand up that we will be persecuted. Not because we are going to lie down. Yes, Yeshua laid down his life so that there's a chance for lost, sinful, dead, dying, blind sheep to come home and be forgiven through repentance and then obeying what you repented from. Because if you go into this verse where Yeshua said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When you open that, and thank you to Yapi, who showed this to me on Facebook. And if just WhatsApp me 082-8933-826. I can send you this whole Bible study from Yapi. But luckily, I also have the Greek and the Hebrew original concordances and Bible. So I could go and confirm if what Yapi said was true. And I opened my Greek concordance at this verse, Luke 23, verse 34. And in the Greek concordance, the original language, well, I'm not going to go into too much detail, but I believe the original scriptures, the whole New Testament, was written by Hebrew people to an Hebrew audience and was later translated into Greek. And that's the only manuscripts, you know, that is available for us today. So in the original Greek manuscripts, and I can show you this in my own Greek concordance, I can send you the picture right now, 082-8933-826. Yeshua was hanging there on the execution stake. He was hanging there for those who want to repent and come back to God. He was hanging there for those who want to repent and come back to God. Even in John 17, Yeshua said, Father, I don't pray for the world. I am not praying for the world. I am praying only for these that you have given me. This is a different side of being a Christian than what we have been taught all our lives. Yeshua was hanging there and he was looking down upon the people who were spitting, cursing, mocking, laughing at him. And although the English says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That is what the Bible calls the lying pen of the scribes, because in the original Greek, it says, Father, forgive them not, for they know what they do. The persecution of these last days, as was the persecution of all God's prophets, as was the persecution of Yeshua, as was the persecution of his disciples and his apostles after him, as was the persecution over the last 2,000 years of real believers, as will be my and your persecution in these last days, will not be because we are going to lie down as floor mats and be trampled upon and shut our mouths and keep quiet and go around humble and turning the other cheek and not standing up and shouting the truth and exposing the darkness and exposing the lies. We will be persecuted because we are going to stand up, not because we're going to be lying down, being trampled upon. We are going to be praying like Yeshua did. Father, I don't pray for this world. John 17, verse 9. Father, I don't pray for the world. I pray for them. For them which you have given me, for they are yours. We become God's. We become his children, his bride, his sheep, his inheritance. We become part of his covenant. When we turn back from sin, which is transgressing his Torah, we repent, the blood of the Lamb is posted on our doorposts, and the angel of death passes us over. That's how you become marked by God's law, because you keep his law and you become God's. You become his possession, you become his. So for those who become his, Yeshua is praying for us. So for those who become his, Yeshua is praying for us, not for the world. And Yeshua was hanging on his execution stake, and he wasn't praying for God to forgive all the people persecuting him. He was praying that God will not forgive them that was persecuting him. Those people that was persecuting him that knew what they were doing. Here in Deuteronomy, we see that God says that all our enemies that hates us and that persecutes us, who knows what they are doing, he will bring all the curses we discussed in the previous sessions. He will bring it upon them. God is a God of forgiveness, but only if you repent. If you don't repent, especially if you knew what you were doing, awaiting you is the horrible judgment of the God of heaven and earth. The Bible says it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. We do not have to be floor mats in this world. We have to have a backbone. Yes, you lay down your life for the kingdom of God. But it took a really strong character to be able to lay down his life and keep his mouth shut, so that the will of God that was prophesied from Genesis 3 verse 15 could come true by the death of the word of God that was transgressed, so that the blood could be available as was symbolized for the previous 4,000 years by the sacrificial system. Strong character of Yeshua inside of you, for you to lay down your life, to keep quiet, to endure the persecution. But that doesn't mean you don't stand up in the persecution, expose the darkness and preach the truth. It doesn't mean that you pray for those that persecute you that know what you do, what they are doing. It doesn't mean that you pray that God will just forgive them. No. If they know what they're doing, Father, these curses that you are warning in your scriptures about will come upon them. And this will encourage us as we go through our daily lives, trying to warn people, trying to bring them back to scripture. We will remember that those who don't know what they are doing, we pray for them because they still have a chance to receive your mercy and turn back to you. But those who know a chance to receive your mercy and turn back to you, but those who know what they are doing have already fallen under your curse. And I don't want to stand anywhere close to them on the day that these curses fall upon them. Because God continues in verse 8 of Deuteronomy 30. You shall make teshuvah. They will be cursed, but you will make teshuvah. You will return and repent. And you will obey the voice of Yahuwah. And you will do all his Torah, which I command you this day. Because when we do that, verse 9, and the rest of the word of God talks about the blessings and the reward that we get for that. And if we don't do that, the scripture, the rest of scripture, all the way to Revelation, about the judgment and the curses that will come upon us. And the ultimate reason, I mean, if we break down everything from Genesis to Revelation, what is the ultimate goal? Is it for you to have a ticket to heaven? Is that the ultimate goal? Is it for you to have eternal life and be blessed forever? Ooh, lucky me. Is it for the world to be recreated and all the animals and plants and human beings to have a joyful life for the rest of eternity? Is it all about us? I want to show you here what the ultimate end goal of all our endurance under persecution will be. What the end goal is, if you really love all your strength, listen to what he says. He says that if you teshuvah, if you turn back to God, if you are not going to remain in this wide road and the masses of people that is rebellious against God, but if you're going to come out of Babylon, my people, follow the narrow road, come back to the God of the Garden of Eden, what's going to happen? Verse 9, Yahuwah will make you have excess in every work of your hand, and in the fruit of your body, and in the fruit of your cattle, and in the fruit of your land, for good, for your own good. So our benefit, our reward will be all these nice things. Yes, we're going to have excess. We're going to have lots of fruit and cattle and children and happiness and peace forever and ever and ever. Amazing, fantastic. But is that the end goal? I want to show you. Amazing, fantastic. But is that the end goal? I want to show you the end goal of this journey that you are on. Listen to your beautiful, wonderful, almighty creator, God, husband, king, redeemer. Listen to his words. Deuteronomy 30, verse 9, the last part. All these good God wants to do to you if you obey him and turn back to him. Because Yahuwah will again gilah over you for good, as he has gilad over Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Gilah Gila means rejoicing. To be cheered up, to be bright, to be happy, to be happy. God himself, as he was happy, as he was cheerful, as he was rejoicing. What is rejoicing? You find joy in something. God rejoiced over Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Abraham chose God. He passed over Ibrit, Hebrew. He passed over out of the land of Babylon, the land of Ur of the Chaldeans. And he came, he believed God's promises, and he came to the promised land. And God rejoiced over him. As God rejoiced over Abraham, God's biggest heart's desire is to rejoice over Abraham's seed, to have the relationship with you that he had with Abraham. And he can only have that relationship with you if you come out from under the world that is in rebellion to his Torah, that automatically brings the curses over you and the death penalty hangs over you. He wants you to repent from that. Recognize your condition. Come out, recognize the roots from the tree of life, from the olive tree. Be grafted back into the commonwealth of Israel, Jacob, so that God can have the covenant relationship with you as he had with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, so that he can also walk this journey from Egypt to the promised land with you. Because what is that going to result in ultimately? Yes, it's going to result in your blessings. Yes, you're going to have all these nice things. Wonderful. Let me give you an applause. It's not about that. The ultimate end goal is for you through all these things. The ultimate end goal is for you through all these things to return to God and bring as many people with you as possible. Because God's heart wants to be filled with joy. Like your heart, if your children is scattered all over the world and you are longing for your children, wouldn't it be wonderful if one by one your children starts coming back to you? And what will be the ultimate end goal? Well, your children is going to come back into your house. They're going to have warmth again and food, and you will look after them, and then they will be happy. But what is the ultimate goal? Your mother or father's heart will be filled again. Your disappointment, your longing, your hartseer, your sadness will be over hot again, because your children has come home. And that is the ultimate goal. That should be your ultimate goal for standing up in a world that is running away from God. And you run back towards God. Not so that you avoid going to hell or avoid the curses or because you want the reward. Just you follow God like he's an ATM machine and you do all these nice things just so that you can get a reward. That should not be our driving force. Your driving force for doing all these things, working as a servant in the tabernacle, praying and spreading the gospel, your end goal should be to bring joy to your father's heart. See your father for the man, for the husband that he is. By a people, a bride, a whoring bride, a scattered, disobedient people, children who ran away from home, like the prodigal son who took his inheritance and squandered it and ended up in the unkosher lifestyle of the pigsty. The father's heart was heartbroken. He was standing on his doorstep every day, looking out on the road. When is my son coming home? And eventually when the son was coming home, it says the father ran out to meet him and embraced him. If you can understand, that is the end goal for you and me, for enduring all the way to the end, because it's not only going to bring you eternal life, it's going to bring joy to your papa's heart, to your husband, joy to your papa's heart, to your husband that has been brokenhearted, your Redeemer that laid down his life for you. The only way to fill his heart with joy, to be part of such a beautiful, good and faithful servant group of people, to be part of that, bringing the harvest in, looking up into your God, into your King's face, seeing tears run down his face, tears of joy. Isn't that the ultimate reward? Forget about, oh, we're going to get so many crowns on our heads, blah, blah, blah. Forget about the rewards for yourself. Think about the reward that you're going to get when you see joy in God's heart. Joy in Yeshua's eyes. That is why you indeed be prepared to stand strong under persecution. That is why you must be prepared to pray hard, work hard in the Spirit. Pray the Word, a fight with a sword of the Word in battle for your family and your friends and for the lost sheep and for the blind house of Judah. That is why we do all this. Father Yahuwah, to bring joy to your heart. That is all we want. Is we want you to finally have your arms filled with all your children again. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our Lord and our God. May our servanthood and our work in the harvest field, rejoicing, Father Yahuwah, may your will be done. May your name be glorified, and may your kingdom come. Amen.